Well, hello there, and Happy New Year! It's the very last week of 2018, which means it's time for our final episode of This Week in Country Music for the Year. I'm Bob Garrett, coming to you live from Nashville, Tennessee, with my partner in crime, Brittany Hodak.
Hey everybody, Happy New Year! Well, Bob, 2018 was a pretty exciting year in country music, I think.
I believe it was. I just think the music was great, and there were some great breakout artists, and we'll get a chance to talk about it. Now, we're going to be covering some of the highlights in today's episode. Regular listeners to the show know that I usually dig into the archives to showcase some of my favorite interviews from superstars from past years.
That's right. And, you know, the Legacy segment is always one of my favorites from the show because it gives me a chance to hear stuff that I've never heard before.
And I hope it's the same way with all our listeners out there. Well, this week we won't be traveling quite as far back in time. All of the interviews are from guests we've had during our shows in 2018, and I thought looking back would be a nice way to end the year.
Well, I think that sounds like a great time, as long as we can also look forward to some of the great things to come in 2019.
Absolutely. It's a deal. Okay, you want to get started with our six?
Let's do it. All right. Now, I know we probably shouldn't pick favorites, but I don't think there's really any hiding who my favorite guest of the year was.
Hello, Dolly. Yes, hello, Dolly. Speaking as someone who was sitting right next to you, it is not a contest. Not even close. You have got a definite case of Dolly fever.
I mean, who wouldn't have Dolly fever? Dolly is amazing. She's an icon.
Mm-hmm.
I would say that talking to her for This Week in Country Music was not only one of the highlights of the show for me, but one of my personal highlights for the entire year. I love her so much. You know, everything she touches turns to gold, and the soundtrack to her Netflix movie, Dumplin', is no exception.
I got to ask you something. Did you happen to watch Jimmy Fallon when she was talking about her husband having a fixation on a threesome?
I did. I was like, what is this? But that's the thing. Like, Dolly always surprises you, right? Like, there's no such thing as a boring Dolly interview or a boring Dolly anything, because she's so much fun.
Yeah. And Jimmy just fell to the ground underneath the desk. Oh, that was hilarious. So what was your favorite thing Dolly talked to us about?
I mean, obviously nothing quite that ground shaking. But I loved hearing her talk about her songwriting process because, you know, she's been so prolific for her entire career. And the fact that she's still writing so much today into her 70s, I thought that was pretty awesome. You want to roll the clip?
Let's do it.
I mean, I know in the past it's said you walk around the kitchen and basically are coming up with songs. Do you just keep it going and write constantly?
It keeps itself going. I have little to do with that. I mean, there's always some music going on in my head. And I have the gift of rhyme, so everything's rhyme. I look at something, if I look at dime, I think of time. I look at, you know, rhyme, I think of time. But I mean, I just am able to do that. But I really am touched by things. I'll be watching TV, somebody will say something, it'll inspire an idea and think, oh, that would make a really good idea for a song. Or that I'm just influenced by living and life. And
do you jot them down as they go on?
I do, because I have to, or I'll forget them, especially this day and time. I'm older now. I can't even remember my name at the time. But yeah, I try to keep a notepad close by. And I always keep a little dictaphone, you know, around, and, you know, whether it's, you know, I've always got something where I don't want to lose a melody. I'll stop what I'm doing and get the flour off my hands if I'm cooking. If I really come up with a great melody, I think, oh, I got to get the guitar. I got to see if this works as good in my hands as it does in my head, and then I'll put down a piece of that just so I don't lose the melody. Then I'll go back to my cooking. Then I can write even with dough on my hands. You know, I can go scribble something down. But anyway, that's just how I do it. It's just a living thing with me. It's a way of life. I don't even think about it. Music is just part of me.
Ooh, what a treasure she is. Here's Dolly's Golden Globe nominated song from Dumplin', Girl in the Movies.
I wanna be the girl in the movies, the one with the glint in her eyes, the girl that seldom loses, beautiful with grace and style, acting out her story, standing in her glory, happy ever after. I wanna be the girl in the movies.
All right, up next, here's another one that I chose. Another critically acclaimed nominated song at that. One of my favorite albums of the year so far was the country music community's cover tribute to Elton John, the Restoration record.
That was a good one, yep.
It was great, right? I mean, just like top to bottom, it was such a good album. All the city's biggest stars paying homage to the beautiful words and music of Elton and Bernie Taupin. And one of the standouts on an album of standout songs, I thought, was the Maren Morris version of Mona Lisa's and Mad Hatters.
Yes, I do remember that. And it wasn't really one of Elton's biggest hits, but really one of his best songs.
Yeah, and I mean, her version of it was just absolutely beautiful, cemented by the fact that it was one of many Grammy nominations that she has for the upcoming awards. Let's listen to a bit of the song.
Sure. That is a beautiful rendition of that song, for sure. You know, I learned a lot about Maren in the interview that you did with her on the show, including some of her highlights from 2018. I'm sure she's going to have a show-stopping collaboration at the Grammys in a few months. I think we should hear what she told you about some of her most memorable onstage partnerships from the past year.
You've had some pretty epic stage performances in the past couple of months. You got to play with Taylor Swift in your hometown, which was really exciting. Mm-hmm. Brandi Carlile, who I know is a hero of yours, mm-hmm. you got to join. And then that epic CMA performance that you had just a week or so back. So yeah. Are there any collaborations that you're hoping to add to that list in 2019, or any kind of bucket list things that as you look toward the new year?
Man, well, what you just listed is like pretty hard to beat. I didn't think I'd get to do things like that, you know, just at the end of an album cycle. I wasn't really like promoting a single at the CMAs this year. So for me to like be in this performance with this, you know, best vocalist of all time, like Mavis Staples and Chris Stapleton, I just felt like I got to bring all my soul out. And then Taylor Swift is like the biggest artist of all time. So I guess like for 2019, it'd be cool to perform. I'm just setting my sights super high. Like Beyonce would be cool. I love like Shania Twain. That would be awesome. I saw that like Eric Church recently got to sing with Bruce Springsteen, and I was so like jealous because I love both Eric and Springsteen. So yeah, Bruce, that'd be a big one for me.
I always love it when people refer to artists as overnight sensations, because usually nothing is further from the truth. You take Luke Combs, okay? He's had a career year in 2018, but despite winning the Best New Artist honors at the CMA and being up for the same honors at the Grammys, he's been plugging away for a long time.
You know, he really has. And it's that kind of dedication, the playing hundreds of small gigs every single year, growing your fan base one night at a time, one fan interaction at a time. That's what builds the kind of foundation that helps cement a lasting career.
And you know, one of the most memorable parts of talking to Luke was hearing the fascinating story behind his breakout hit Hurricane. It's a cool story because it kind of mirrors what we've just been talking about. The song was, you know, released more than once, you know, did okay the first time. And then, well, let's hear him tell the story.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting story. You know, I had kind of produced a little EP, Scott Moffitt did. And I didn't have anything going on. I didn't have a publisher or, you know, even a manager or anything going on. And we recorded six songs and with money that I had saved up, and we wanted to go in and master the tunes, and I didn't really have the money to master all of them. So I sat down and listened to Hurricane, and it was the one that sounded the most done. So we went with putting that out, kind of on its own, just as a single on iTunes, and it took off, man. And we sold 14,000 copies of it that week and used that money to pay for the rest of the EP, which led to kind of an independent deal, and then and then obviously moved on to Sony. So yeah, it's a crazy story.
Everybody listening probably knows Hurricane by heart at this point. So I chose another song to include in our six. If you don't know it, you should definitely check it out. It's called Must Have Never Met You.
I guess whoever said the grass is greener must have never seen the other side. What don't kill you makes you stronger. Sure sounds like a lie. And whoever said that time heals everything and everything will be alright. Whoever said it ain't the end of the world and you'll find somebody new. Must have never met you.
Another artist who's been around for a long time and people think he's an overnight sensation is Kane Brown. He had a monster year as well in 2018. Got himself married. He sure as heck did, and his wife now has become an integral part of his music song selection, okay? Apparently, he runs all of the songs he's going to record past her.
I've got some songs that I wanted on the album that I was in love with, but I'd show it to her, and she'd be like, nah. I feel like you have better songs. Anyway, it would kind of, like, hurt me, you know, like stabbing my heart, but it was like, you know what? That's why I love her. She tells me straight up.
Yeah, well, did she when you calmed down a little bit? Did she whatever she had to say? Did you say, you know what, she could be right?
I didn't even question her. I was like, she don't like it, I'm not putting it on.
Apparently, she liked this one a lot too. Here's Kane with "It Ain't You, It's Me."
But it ain't you that's been going through hell. It ain't you with a heart for sale. It ain't you right around this town with the ghost and the shotgun.
One of the most powerful new voices that country fans discovered this year belongs to Rachel Wammack. Now, you talked to her all the way back in episode 3.
Yep.
And something that stuck out to me was the story of how she was discovered in her hometown of Muscle Shoals.
You mean it wasn't me trying to get her name right?
I mean, that was pretty entertaining. But you know how I remember it now?
How?
Wah, wah. Like a sad trombone?
Oh, yeah. Why didn't I think of that earlier? So it's Rachel Wah, wah, Wammack.
Well, yeah, I mean, I don't think she's going to want to be called Wah-Wah-Mac. But yeah, like, you know, I try to imagine in her head, she's like, Wah-Wah, another person messing up my last name every day of my life.
Okay, kid, whatever works for you. Here's Rachel Wammack talking about her big break.
It was really, really wild when I first moved here because I didn't have a deal when I moved. Although I did know a guy from Sony who I'd met when I was 17 and he poured into me, and I'm from Muscle Shoals, Alabama, and he just so happened to be staying in Muscle Shoals on a golf trip when I'm performing at one of my regular spots, and that's a really rare kind of thing, is being discovered in your hometown. I feel like a lot of people move here to be discovered, and I had met someone who ended up being my mentor from Muscle Shoals while I was there. And but when I moved to Nashville, it was very surreal because there is a magic about this place, even separate from Muscle Shoals, which has its own magic.
Sure.
And I am very, very grateful to have been a part of this journey.
And here's Rachel's debut single, Damage.
Last but not least, here is another Grammy nominee, this one for Best Country Solo Performance.
Ah, you must be talking about Mr. Keith Urban. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, in addition to a Grammy nod, he's also the reigning CMA Entertainer of the Year.
You know, I think that was probably one of the most popular awards given out this year. And Keith is really, really well-liked in town, and he works hard for his career, and he also works hard for other people. He's involved in a great deal of charities. He's a good man. I had a chance to talk to Keith about his latest album, Graffiti U, all the way back on the original episode of our podcast. And then I was listening back, trying to choose my favorite part, and I thought, why not share something that we didn't share before?
Ah, you're breaking the rules.
Yeah,
a little different format.
Uh-huh. So I know you, and I said we were going to do this greatest hits sort of interview, but I'm going to dig a little bit deeper into that particular interview, and you're going to learn some cool things.
Okay, I like it. What you got?
Do you ever take the time and go back and listen to any of your ranch albums and see how you've progressed?
Yeah, I listened to that maybe about a month ago. I had to listen to some songs off that record. Because when I'm putting a tour together, I always go back through the albums to see if there's some unusual album cuts that might be good to dust off. And I was really pleased with that album. That album hits me in a different way because than a lot of other people, because I know where I was at in my life when I recorded it, and it was not a good place. It was a lot of upheaval in my life. I was going through a lot of things. But there's still a... there's a real, there's a spirit on that ranch record that I love. Yeah, still.
Do you feel the growth of your musicianship?
Yeah, I do. I feel getting more comfortable in the studio. The studio was a bit overwhelming still when we did the ranch record, even though I'd made an album before that. It still felt a little bit intimidating. And that got less and less over the years. Really from Golden Road on, I started to really explore the space and have fun in the studio.
A couple of quick questions. Do you, as your children are growing, do you see any of them moving in either direction to their future interest, whether it be a musician or whether it would be an actress?
Well, right now, of course, there's a lot of music in our house.
Yeah.
So they both are interested in singing. But with what mom does as well, there's a lot of being on film sets. So Sunday has expressed a bit of interest in directing. And she's got a little...
Really?
Yeah, she has a little iPad that has this iMovie stuff on it. And she does a huge amount of filming of her sister and other people, you know, putting together little scenes in the backyard.
Wow.
And then she comes in and edits it. And she's
How old is she?
She's nine.
Ah.
She's taken a few little, you know, basic editing classes and how to put music into it. And so we would both love her to become a director.
So she does all the lock to pictures and all that sort of?
It's very basic, of course, because she's nine, but she's got a genuine interest, I think, in telling stories.
Does mom look it over and see what it looks like? And
you know? Yeah, I mean, we're both just trying to be supportive right now, because if her passion's there, we're going to support it, whatever it's for.
Wow.
Yeah, so,
but if one of them said, hey, I want to be a musician, would you be saying, you sure?
It's been a pretty good life for me.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, but at the end of the day, if it's your passion,
you gotta
no one's going to say yay or nay either way. You're going to do it because it's your calling. But the thing we remind them both of is you've got to work at it. It doesn't matter what it is. I mean, mom and I are still working at it because, first of all, it's what you love to do, but secondly, it's never-ending. It's never-ending learning.
All right, well, here's Nicole's Grammy-nominated, CMA-winning husband singing Parallel One.
So come on and take a little bit of my heart tonight. No, I literally don't mind. Just please don't misplace it. Take a little bit of my heart tonight. No, baby, be mine now. Baby, be mine now. Maybe it's time we put our hearts in a parallel line.
Okay, Britt, do you have any New Year's resolutions?
Not really. I'm not really much of a resolutions gal.
I break them all. That's why I don't make them.
Well, I mean, it's easier to keep them if you don't have them, I guess.
Yep.
I'm planning on writing a book in 2019. I don't know if that counts.
Seriously?
It's not really a resolution. It's just something I've been meaning to do for a while that I'm going to finally make sure I get around to in 2019.
Now, wait a minute. You are so young. What, you know, you know, what are you going to write about? You're not believing in Santa Claus when you were four or what?
No, it's not like a memoir. It's a business book about super fandom.
Oh!
The psychographic that makes people over-index in their affinity to certain things.
That you are qualified
like country
to
music.
Do.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Fandom.
As far as I'm concerned, like I said, I really don't, keep much of them. I try, but you know, about 30 days in, I'm back to the old bub.
Wait, so what are you going to break? What's the resolution that you've already set yourself up for failure?
Well, you know, I know I'm not supposed to eat a lot of sweets and I'm not supposed to eat a lot of high carb food. And I'll say, okay, this is here. I'm going to do right. I'm going to, you know, I'm not going to do that. And I'm going to exercise more. And I get in about 30 days and, you know, I start to have the pasta.
Well, you know what? Even cutting back for 30 days is good. Like, that's a win.
You think I might have added one more or 6 months to my life by doing that?
Yeah, I don't know quite how the math works out, but I know it's not hurting you, so.
Yeah. All right.
So
well,
I think that should be celebrated.
That made me feel better. Okay.
All right. Well, do you have any predictions that you want to make for country music in 2019?
Well, I think there's been a great deal of media about women in country music. And I think that there's enough talent out there that I think that we're going to see maybe two, possibly three breakthrough female artists in 2019. Okay. These are people that have been introduced in 2018 who will, you know, so far you can't really count like Lauren Elena as a breakthrough artist because she had a major hit. And then she hasn't had one since. The key to me is when they have consistent Carrie Underwood type hits, when they become automatically added to the playlists and start to move quickly up the charts as opposed to in itty bitty increments. Okay. I think we're going to start to see a bit more of that. There's just too much talent to ignore.
All right. Well, I hope you're right. I hope the freeze out is over.
Yeah. I don't know that it's necessarily a freeze out. I don't know that it's absolutely necessary deliberate, but you know.
Well, it's a double standard because when there's a new male artist being introduced, people say, oh, it's about the song. It's about the song. The best song wins. And when there's a new female artist, programmers say, oh, well, she doesn't have a story. Like, we're really looking for somebody that's got more artist development. It's a total double standard, but hopefully it's over.
Well, I think the same thing applies to, you know, hardcore traditional country music. There's a lot of really good stuff out there, stuff that's every bit as good as any of the high contemporary type stuff. A lot of this started to happen, Brittany, when the national charts became national instead of local, okay? And, you know, because there's a lot of coordination involved. So in this particular case, I think radio will respond, and I think we're going to start to see some movement in that direction. At least I certainly hope so.
I hope so, too. I hope you're right. All right. Well, you know, I can't believe that the year is virtually over. Like, it's like, where did it go?
It really did fly by. I mean, my goodness gracious. I guess we should recognize some of the 2018's biggest winners, okay?
All right, let's do it. Well, you know, Jason Aldean was crowned Entertainer of the Year way back in April at the ACM Awards.
Third time.
Feels like it was forever
ago. Three in a row.
Yeah. And Keith Urban took the same title at the CMA Awards, as we've talked about. Album of the Year honors at those shows went to Chris Stapleton and Casey Musgraves, respectively. Over on the live side, Kenny Chesney was the winner by far. He played to 1.3 million fans across the U.S. this
year. Question for you.
Yes.
Now, this next year, 2019, he's supposed to not be playing the big stadiums, and he's going to go to more intimate type of settings. So I wonder why that is. I wonder why he chose to pull back from playing the big, big shows and get back to the smaller venues.
Yeah. I haven't talked to his team about that. I would imagine he probably just is looking for a change. I mean, he usually plays all the same stadiums. Playing arenas is also a little more, or a little less seasonal, I should say. Like, it's not bound to, you know, just be a summer tour.
So he's saying he's playing arenas. He's not talking about going into the clubs and stuff like that.
Wouldn't that be cool, though, if he was?
Like, he likes to do that, especially the college towns. He loves that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like once you get to a certain level, it's hard to do that, not only from a, you know, ticketing crowd management standpoint, but also, like, you get used to a certain level of production. But
he's always been a great marketer throughout the year. He's always been fan-friendly, and he may feel that he just needs to get right back into that touch them type of mode.
I mean, that would be great. I would go to see that show. Who wouldn't want to go see Kenny Chesney at a bar, right?
Yep.
All right. Well, the best-selling country album of the year honors went to your buddy Luke Combs. This one's for you, reigned on top of the charts. And of course, Luke also nabbed the CMA Award for New Artist of the Year. The second best-selling album was Kane Brown's Experiment, which is a pretty impressive accomplishment when you figure that Kane only had 6 or 7 weeks to get up there on the chart.
Kudos to Sony Music. Basically, they have developed these two artists. And they are now superstars and the future of that label. And that is to be congratulated. It's not easy to do.
Yeah, great job, everybody. Thomas Rhett and Luke Bryan were the two most played artists at country radio, while the year's most popular songs were Florida Georgia Line's Meant to Be, Kane Brown's Heaven, and Dan and Shay's Tequila.
Tequila, Dan and Shay. Now that, in my judgment, that's the breakthrough artist of the year. That
yeah.
album, that self-titled album, put them on the map to superstardom. Tequila, monster hit. The current singles is the number one song in the country. These two young guys have quietly built a career, and now they're on top, man.
Well, and you know, Speechless and Tequila are actually back-to-back on the Hot Country Songs chart, number one and number two. And that's only ever happened 5 times in history before. 5 other acts have had the number one and number two songs. Any guesses as to who those are?
No, not a clue.
It's Florida Georgia Line, Luke Bryan, Taylor Swift, Willie Nelson, and Buck Owens. So good, good company for Dan and Shay to be in to end out the year.
Speaking of looking ahead, okay, folks, I just heard or just read that there is going to be a monster Willie Nelson tribute television show. Anybody and everybody, including Willie, will be performing on this. It'll be taped for national television, and we're going to be telling you more about that as time goes along. It'll be the event of the early part of 2019.
Wow, I'm Willie looking forward to that.
You're Willie looking forward to that. Oh, I should reach over there. Okay, it's been a great year. I got to tell you, it's been a blast and an honor recapping it right here with you, Britt.
This has been so much fun. Thanks to everybody out there for listening, downloading, and for sending us all your feedback. Please be sure to rate and review the show on iTunes. And remember to hit that subscribe button so you get all the new episodes sent straight to your phone.
And you can check out our playlist, This Week in Country Music, and all your favorite streaming sites to hear full versions of the songs that we talked about today, plus much, much more. You can also play our old episodes for full versions of the interviews we shared today, plus my sit-downs with Old Dominion, Mitchell Tenpenny, Jimmy Allen, Russell Dickerson, your interview with Dolly, and a whole lot more. Okay, I'm Bob Guerra.
And I'm Brittany Hodak, wishing you a very happy new year from everyone at This Week in Country Music.
Okay, what did you do with my little...